gone about trying to include people in that to get scale?
I think the assumptions about poor, assumptions about people are extremely important. So therefore, there is a need for change in mindset about thinking about poor. If we look at poor people, they're extremely innovative. They have to innovate because every day is a struggle. So how do we build on the strengths of the poor? If we crack this, then scale and other things are not issues. Our basic assumption in, you know, in the program, in the work that we did in Andhra Pradesh, and also what we're going to do at the national level, is that building institutions of the poor. And we worked with women's groups, but there could be youth groups, there could be farmers groups, but this core institution, institution of the poor, that's the women's self-help group movement, and these self-help groups being federated at various levels adds to the strength of the institutions of the poor. And the core assumption behind the programs for poverty eradication at the national level is that building such grassroots institutions of the poor is critical to enable their energies to be unleashed, to enable their innovations to actually see the light of the day. So in my view, every human being is an innovator. And since the poor face so many hurdles, so their innovations are more, let us say, there's a sense of urgency about innovation. It's not a leisure. It's not a luxury. It's necessity. And therefore, we have such great energy in the country, but that energy has been stifled. And we see the role of NGOs, role of government, role of such wonderful people here on the panel who are working in the social sector as facilitators in the process of building such institutions of the people. I also believe that the scale is not government trying to do it, is not, you know, business thinking that it can do it. Scale would be, in my view, and that's a basic model on which we have worked, is where the people's institutions themselves throw up leaders who are able to incubate such institutions on their own. And we call these innovators as community resource persons, community best practitioners. So we invest heavily on such innovators. And therefore, so the scale is not done by government or by any other institution. Scaling is done by the people themselves. And therefore, it's, you know, it has its own logic. There is an initial period of 4 or 5 years when this model has to sort of establish itself. And that's where I like the point Mr. Shankaranarayan made, that you have to get it right first. Once you get it right, the people who have done it are the people who can scale it up. So in my view, if we do at least 10% correctly, 5 to 10%, that's the tipping point. Then you have enough social capital which is able to do it on their own. And also you need a long-term perspective because these models are continuously improving, learning from failures, accessing opportunities, and then growing into, you know, in many sectors. So therefore, the longer this, over a period of time, you have richer innovators who have, you know, done many things. So therefore, you are engaged in the process of building a virtuous cycle. And also, I believe a good ecosystem is important, where government, NGOs, the private sector, the banks, all of them see their role in enabling the institutions of the poor to to achieve the objectives of their members and who believe that their business interest lies in these institutions flourishing. I just would like to give end with an example. When the program in Andhra Pradesh started in 95, it was part of a pilot program sponsored by UNDP called the South Asia Poverty Alleviation Program. And the government decided to scale it up in year 2000. Those years, the banks used to see lending to the poor, lending to the self-help groups as an obligation. But whereas in Andhra Pradesh today, for more than 50% of the rural bank branches, lending to the self-help group is their most important portfolio, is the most profitable portfolio. So it's become a business for them. So it's a business where the poor are benefiting and where the banks are benefiting. So do you have an ecosystem where there is a stake for everybody and everybody is equally well informed, and the, at least as facilitators, we see our role in poor unleashing their energies and full achieving their, whatever is their genius. That's how I see it. Then scale is not an issue, because it's a concern of the people themselves to scale up what helps them solve the problem of their members. So that's the way I look at it.
That's very interesting, and it is something Sumita talked about, and we'll come back to that. But I want to bring in Srikanth Sastry over here. And you've said before that in a country like India, we perhaps need a non-traditional model to reach out to the maximum number of people. And that doesn't necessarily mean including corporates or including the government even, or including NGOs, which of course rules out a lot of the people right here. So you tell us, if you had to create this model, what would it be?
I think Sumita ended the last presentation by talking about a unique Indian way. And I think the model has to be uniquely Indian. But before I get to that, let me make my position clear. I believe that scale is important. India has big problems, many problems that we haven't solved for 60 years because of the government's failure and in spite of the efforts of well-meaning donors. So we need scale from a market-based model. So that's my starting position. Having said that, the alternative model that I see does involve all these players. I did not certainly mean. The way I see the scale being built up is, let's take entrepreneurs like Sumita or Ashwin, who have built a proof of concept, which is what I think both these gentlemen referred to. They've showed that there is a model that can work. Now they're ready to scale up. If that be the case, how can various stakeholders get together to help them scale up? There is a role for private equity, there is a role for government, and there is a role for civil society to make that happen. How can the government make that happen? And I think the government has already taken steps in that direction. If you look at the variety of public-private partnership initiatives, for example, in skills development, NSDC, it's providing funding to so many entrepreneurs who want to create employability-related ventures. That's one direction. We heard Sam Pitroda this morning. He didn't mention it today, but one of the initiatives the government is proposing is creating a national innovation fund, which will act like a fund of funds to support funds that want to support social enterprises. So the government has a role to provide a certain amount of capital, because private equity people like Shankar will not want to come and put up money for things which have a long gestation period, which is where the government has a role to play. I think that is one. The second role I see is a definite role for civil society to engage in a debate. I would go beyond what he said. He said when you do microfinance, you must provide information and educate. I don't think that's enough. Because look at when you or I take a home loan. We sign a 30-page document with lots of fine print. The information is theoretically provided to us, but neither you or I, with our education, know what is inside it. I think when it comes to public domain and social sector, there has to be debate, a vibrant debate. If it is microfinance, there has to be a debate about what is the right interest rate to charge. If it is about public clean drinking water, it's a debate about what's the right price to charge. I think once that debate happens and the heat is all vented out, it'll settle down to business as usual thereafter. So I see a role for civil society in providing a point of view. I see a role for an ombudsman to come in and be a referee in a situation where there is an issue like this. He spoke about a regulator, but you need a regulator. You need civil society to engage in a debate. And I think the unique Indian model, therefore, will be built on the back of entrepreneurs who created a proof of concept, supported by government with certain kind of funding which requires long gestation period, definitely a role for private equity to provide the money for further growth, and a role for civil society to, civil society has a great deal of experience in running ground level programs. I think they have a role to play in implementation of this. They have a role to play to infuse talent into such enterprises. These are not two different worlds. Where will they hire talent from? If Sumita is in the hills of Uttarakhand or Himachal mobilizing artisans, her talent pool to manage that is going to come from the NGO sector. So this is going to be a uniquely Indian model which will create thousands of social entrepreneurs, which will create impetus for India.
Mr. Vijay Kumar, I see you nodding and agreeing with what Srikanth is saying. So what do you think of this uniquely Indian model? Is that something you could see working in this context?
The way I look at it is, who is driving this? Who is in the driver's seat? If initially, of course, you will need catalysts. You will need NGOs, you will need business, you will need government, you need markets. But I may be wrong, but I think ultimately, if we are looking at about 600, 700 million population, the ultimate drivers have to be people themselves, articulated through institutions that they own. So once we do that correctly, then everybody else has a role in trying to enable this to grow such a way that both benefit. And it's possible.
So you and I talked about this a little while ago, that it's the people themselves who can create scale. You don't have to depend on a large company coming in there to create scale, to affect more people. So can you explain what you mean by that? How is it that the artisans, for example, themselves, how is it that the people at the bottom of the pyramid who can create scale?
I'd just like to link it up to the question of, to the point about what is the Indian way. You know, when I was setting up Rang Sutra, I initially started it off like a cooperative, registered it as a producer company, which is something that the government of India is promoting and others are promoting as a cooperative model. Very soon, I realized that there were limitations there. And I think what now at Rang Sutra, which is now a public limited company of over 1,000 artisans and others, what the way we are able to scale up is that we have looked beyond the us and them kind of an approach. You have the very cooperative or left-leaning approach, which is, there is labor and there should be the owner. You have a very capitalistic approach that I have the capital, so I am the boss and I am going to dictate. Both these are not going to work. So in Rang Sutra, what we've tried out and successfully so far, touch wood, is that we have representatives of artisans. The artisan is dependent on the market. So it's treading a fine balance, but ultimately that working towards that harmony seems the only sustainable way ahead, rather than an us and them and who's trying to get maximum out of whom. So I think in that sense,